Hi everyone, it's an absolute pleasure to be here with you all. It's a good evening from me in South Africa, and I'm sure a good morning or good afternoon to the rest of you. I'm really pleased to be doing my bit, helping you guys stay safe at home during these really interesting times we're facing. And before we get into the presentation I'm going to be sharing with you guys tonight, just a few housekeeping rules for everybody out there. We are recording this presentation, so a link will be shared with you all after this presentation, so feel free to share widely afterwards, and that will include addressing some of the questions and Q&A at the end of the presentation as well. On to the questions and Q&A, if you guys have any questions for me through the presentation, please feel free to write those questions in our Q&A box within the Zoom meeting room. And we will do our very best to address all your questions through the presentation. If unfortunately we don't get to your question, we will definitely deal with them after the presentation, and I'll get those answers back to you as soon as possible following the presentation. So a warm welcome to everybody, to my friends and colleagues on the African continent and in the US and around the world. Warm welcome to those of you who I haven't met before, but it's a pleasure to e-meet you virtually. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Tanya Smith, and I'm the South African Regional Manager for the African Crane Conservation Program, which is a program that's in partnership between the International Crane Foundation based in the US and the Endangered Wildlife Trust, which is a local NGO based here in South Africa. It's a fully integrated partnership program, and we work across sub-Saharan Africa to secure cranes and the habitat on which cranes and ourselves as people depend. So today I'm going to be sharing with you guys just a small part of the work that we do, specifically looking at how are we making our skies safer for South Africa's crane species. So I really hope you guys enjoy the presentation. Feel free to engage with questions, and I'm sure I can learn as much from all of you as hopefully you learn from me through this presentation. So to kick off, I'd like to share with you guys a little bit about South Africa's three crane species. We have three of the world's 15 crane species right here in a fairly small country. And I feel, maybe biasly, probably the three most beautiful crane species in the world. So kicking off, we have our grey crown crane. It's also our most ancient of the 15 crane species. It is unfortunately listed as endangered and is also the fastest declining crane species in the world. We then have our largest crane in Africa. It's our wattled crane. If I was standing and you guys saw how tall I was, you would see that an adult wattle crane stands as tall as me, which is a little over 5 foot. So substantial birds. They are listed critically endangered in South Africa with an estimated 380 wattle cranes in our country, but listed vulnerable globally. Their stronghold is definitely within the floodplains of southern central Africa. Thirdly, our third species is our national bird, and it's our blue crane. It's listed as vulnerable globally and near threatened locally. It's also a near endemic species with about 95% of the world's populations of blue crane found here in South Africa. So where are cranes found? If we take a closer look at where generally our cranes are found in the country, looking at our crane hotspots for blue cranes, we have our largest population of blue cranes in natural habitat occurring within the Karoo region, which is essentially that central region, semi-arid region of South Africa. The photo on the left there is showing that the typical habitat of the Karoo landscape, short shrubby bushes interspersed with some grass species. The largest stronghold by far is actually in the Western Cape, which is an agricultural landscape of pasture and wheat. The natural habitat of fynbos has been removed and replaced with wheat and pasture for sheep farming and wheat production for cereal cropping. So this area in the Western Cape is made up of two regions that we refer to as the Swartland, up the west coast of South Africa, north of Cape Town, and the Overberg, which is along the southeastern coast, east of Cape Town. These two areas collectively hold more than 50% of the world's populations of blue cranes. The picture on the left there shows the typical habitat of a cereal crop, wheat crop that's been harvested. In terms of grey crowned and wattle cranes, the eastern part of our country is definitely their stronghold. It's the wetter part of our country, generally high rainfall. And these landscapes on the east are dominated by grasslands interspersed with maize agricultural fields and wetlands within those landscapes. So highly suitable habitats for our two wetland dependent species, the grey crowned and wattle cranes. So looking at some trends with our crane numbers in South Africa, it's very heartening to see that all three crane species are showing increasing trends within South Africa. And I think something that's testament to nearly three decades of concerted conservation efforts. And I know many of you who have been involved in crane conservation in South Africa are online today listening to this. And I think this is really a hats off to you and to everybody that's been involved in crane conservation in this country. And it does show with some concerted conservation efforts, we can reverse declines in crane species, which were evident in all three of our species not so long ago, less than two decades ago. So looking very closely at grey crowned cranes, this is looking at the numbers that have been counted on an annual aerial survey that is conducted within their stronghold in a province called KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa. This is an area that holds about 70% of our country's population of grey crowned cranes. And those numbers there over the last 17 years are showing really nice increases, genuine increases in grey crowned crane numbers across their core range. And then when we move over to wattle cranes, we're seeing a similar trend. Although smaller population sizes, the population trend also from about 2000 showing an somewhat increasing trend for overall numbers, and a stabilization and slight increasing trend for new breeding pairs of wattle cranes that we're seeing in the country. This is also numbers and counts from their wattle crane core home range or core area, also in KwaZulu-Natal. And this is an area that holds about 90% of our country's wattle crane population. So a really nice snapshot of how the majority of our population is doing over the last 20 years or so. Moving on to our third species and our flagship for this presentation is our national bird, the blue crane. Also seeing very similar trends across some of their core range, particularly in the Western Cape, their range in the Overberg. That those trends that you see there on the left-hand side are trends from citizen science data that's been collected using what's called the Coordinated Avifaunal Road Count process, which has been running for over two decades in this country, and showing really nice increasing trends from a bird density perspective. So the number of birds per 100 kilometers of routes driven. Also on the right-hand side there, it's trend data from KwaZulu-Natal, a population sample of our grassland population in the blue crane. So although a small proportion of our country's population as a whole, also showing really nice heartening increasing trends within the eastern grasslands of our country. So when we look closely at one of the major threats faced by cranes, power line collisions, it's important to know what to look for and what the difference is between power line collisions and electrocutions. So as most of you know, cranes, other than our crown crane species, are unable to perch on trees or poles and therefore are not really susceptible to electrocutions as a form of mortality related to power lines. They are, however, vulnerable to power line collisions, so colliding with overhead power lines within the landscapes. And collisions usually, the way to tell the difference between collisions and electrocutions is that generally collisions occur mid-span, and generally as a result of the bird not seeing the line until it's too late to maneuver away from the power line. And unlike electrocutions, collisions are a lot more difficult to alleviate or mitigate and to predict as well. So there's a whole lot of factors at play that determine the risk of collision for a certain species or a group of species. Those factors could be topography, for example. So in this photo that you see here with the line, the power line is obscured by the background topography, the high mountainous areas that make it very difficult to see the line against the background. It's also driven by land use, surrounding land use. So the presence of agricultural lands that may be attracting birds to feed, for example. Birds' biology in general, the height that they fly, the areas they move, and the landscapes they use. Water bodies for roosting, used for roosting, and also weather conditions all contribute to collision risk. But generally speaking, large terrestrial birds and water birds are most affected by collisions with power lines. And this is obviously an unnatural mortality that is difficult for populations or species that are vulnerable to account for alleviating those that impact of collisions. So looking more specifically at cranes and power lines in general in South Africa, we're really proud of how far we've come in terms of trying to understand the impact of power lines on our crane species. And in 2009, some surveys that were completed in the stronghold for blue cranes in the Overberg modeled collision rates for blue cranes, estimated 12% of the Western Cape population is annually killed through power line collisions. And that roughly translates to 0.25 birds per kilometer per year. So essentially one bird per for every 4 kilometers of distribution lines within that area. So fairly substantial estimates within that area. Also looking at survival estimates that have been determined for blue cranes, this has been done using ringing, color ringing or color tagging projects and resighting of those birds. In the Karoo study in 2009, looked at survival estimates of 3 age classes. So juvenile birds of less than a year old, but fledged, immature birds of 1 to 3 years old, and then adult birds of 4 years and older. And the interesting thing there is the difference between the Western Cape and the Karoo survival estimates, particularly looking at the difference in the adult survival between the Western Cape and the Karoo populations. Some of this difference could be explained by potentially ring loss that's occurred in those areas, but some of it may be a genuine reduction in crane survival for adults as a result of potentially power line collisions in the Western Cape area. Looking at wattled cranes, we've recently had a PhD student complete PhD thesis looking at wattled crane survival, also looking at using ringing and resighting data. And that came up with a post-fledging survival estimate of 0.83. So about 83% of fledglings are making it through to adulthood. So how do we go about addressing this threat? So those are definitely significant numbers that we are concerned about. Blue cranes are also the most impacted species in terms of number of individuals that have been recorded as being killed on through power line collisions. And the most number of incidents that have been recorded in this country. And I think the first step and probably the boldest step we've taken in this country is the Endangered Wildlife Trust and Eskom entered into a strategic partnership in 1996 in order to reduce the negative wildlife and energy interactions that were taking place, particularly in a focus with vultures, vulture electrocution, as well as crane collisions. And that strategic partnership has continued to develop and grow over the years to a point where it's a mutually beneficial partnership where all of the work and inputs from EWT has been mainstreamed into Eskom's, which is our main power service provider, been mainstreamed into their business operations. We've also looked at both reactive and proactive approaches, which is underpinned by research and development and are currently being implemented across the country. To date, marking of power lines is, in order to increase visibility, is the most common method we're using to reduce collision risk. But there are obviously alternative methods to reduce collision risk. But at this stage, we are using mostly marking of power lines. Here you can see a close-up photo of one of the more typical dynamic bird flapper designs that are fitted onto the power lines. There are also other tools that are used that are more static designs, but this is a dynamic bird diverter which moves as a result of wind in the air. I think what is key for us as well is that proaction is key. We cannot just be reacting to collisions and power line incidences related to cranes and other bird species. So we really have focused over the years around trying to be as proactive as possible and addressing or reducing collision risk proactively before the issue surfaces. So one of the ways we've been able to do this is looking at completing a collision risk mapping exercise for South Africa, which uses 5 collision prone species in order to guide proactive marking on existing lines and also guiding proactive marking on any new power lines that fall within very high or high collision risk areas. Obviously, this area is still vast. The results of this modeling is still really vast. And what we need to do is look at specific collision risks for species where we can account for species biology, such as movement obtained through satellite tracking in order to understand collision sensitivities for those 5 species individually within South Africa. In addition to that, I think one of the major contributors to reversing the decline for wattled cranes was that in 2000, Eskom marked all power lines within 500 meters of active wattle crane breeding sites in South Africa in order to reduce the collision risk to breeding pairs on territory and or the fledgling chick that is produced on territory. That's a substantial amount of power lines that has been proactively marked and went a long way to reducing collision risk for all our breeding pairs within the country. Obviously, with regards to cranes and crane biology, cranes like to use roost sites. And generally speaking, they will use the same roost site for a period of time until that roost site becomes unsuitable. For example, if the water levels reduce or lower to a point where the cranes are no longer able to use that as a roost site. So one of the issues with mitigating collision risk at roost sites is obviously being able to make the power line visible in low light conditions. So we were really privileged to work with Eskom on a proactive line marking and line testing at a roost site in the Western Cape, which accommodates over 1,000 blue cranes every evening that come in low light conditions and leave the roost site in low light conditions. The standard bird flight diverters that I showed you earlier were fitted to the lines quite extensively, but were ineffective in curbing the collision rates we were seeing around this roost site. So it provided an ideal site for testing of a new device called an UL device, which is essentially a device that is armed with an LED charging panel on the top of the device. And it's a mixture of a static and a dynamic bird flight diverter. That LED solar panel charges a battery for an LED light, which essentially lights up against the flapper in low light conditions, increasing the visibility of that line quite significantly. This proved incredibly effective at reducing collisions for blue cranes at the roost site. We had over 40 carcasses collected over a 2-month period prior to fitting these old devices. And to date, over a 1-year period following fitting of these devices, we only picked up 2 blue crane collisions thereafter. So highly effective devices for low light conditions and making power lines at roost sites much safer for cranes. I think the question we get asked really often is, does marking really work? I mean, I've alluded in the previous slides that marking does work, but unless we underpinned our response by really good research, it's hard to sort of convert the skeptical, especially when it's a fairly expensive process for power supplies to implement. So we need to be pretty sure that what we're asking power supplies to do does really work and is cost effective and lasts. So we undertook, as the Eskom EWT Strategic Partnership, a controlled experiment spanning 8 years to measure the effectiveness of marking of transmission lines specifically in reducing collisions by large terrestrial birds. They used 2 different flight diverter types, both the dynamic and the static devices. And in relation to that, they also looked at a bird visual study to understand how our collision-prone species or groups of species like bustards, cranes, and storks see in order to guide future technological advances and mitigation measures. So obviously we are designing generally across the world mitigation devices based on how we can see as humans. But obviously the bird's visual field of vision is very different to humans. So understanding a field of vision and how that makes them prone to collision, or potentially how that guides the effect, understanding the effectiveness of the marking goes a long way. So the main findings from that research was really heartening. Over the 8-year period of the research study, we showed very strongly that bird flight diverters proved to reduce blue crane collisions by 92%. So highly effective mitigation measures for cranes, particularly for blue cranes here in this country. And it also proved to reduce collisions of all large birds, so collectively all large birds, excluding bustards by 56%. What is interesting there, I say excluding bustards, unfortunately, in this country and probably across the continent and globally, most mitigation measures in terms of marking the line is proving very ineffective for bustards. At least that is definitely what we're seeing in South Africa. So we've still got a long way to go in terms of addressing power line collision risk for bustard species. Another interesting finding was previously the procedure for fitting of the markers spoke to fitting of markers within the inner 3/5 of the span. So this was mostly to sort of save money, I suppose, and also with understanding that generally collisions occur mid-span between the two structures. However, what we found with the research is that if you marked the inner 3/5, we tended to divert collisions to the outer 2/5 of those spans. So this really informed now our procedure and policies for Eskom technical when they go out and mitigate power lines. Flappers or markers are fitted to the full span, the full 5/5 between the spans. So what's really heartening is that we know marking works, and we at least know from 2009 that the kind of impact power lines have on blue cranes from a collision perspective. But what we don't know is what is happening now. What is the collision rates and the level of threat for blue cranes currently? And also what we don't know is what are the collision rates for some of the other stronghold areas. So the collision rates we do know from 2009 are from one part of their core range. And there are three major core range, core hotspots for blue cranes. And we need to understand what is the collision risk, collision rates for blue cranes across those three hotspots. We also need to understand what is the current state of the population. Most of our current estimates or understanding of the state of the population is really out of date in South Africa. And by understanding the current state of the population, the extent of these current threats, and potentially understanding how this might change in the future based on understanding of a predicted changes driven by climate change and other socioeconomic changes within South Africa, we need to understand the current status and the current level of threat and how that potentially is going to change in the future in order to direct conservation action in the future. So we're really trying to be proactive around our conservation efforts for blue cranes moving forward. So for the purpose of the rest of this presentation, I'm going to focus specifically on understanding the current threat for power lines for blue cranes in 2020, essentially, and also sort of understanding some of the biology of the species through satellite tracking. So all of this work is falling under a PhD. We have a student that's conducting a 3-year PhD, really looking at trying to get the answer of understanding the viability of the world's population of blue cranes, essentially, in the face of a changing landscape. So in order to determine collision rates for blue cranes within the core range and its impact on population viability, and to determine collision sensitivity for the species to guide proactive marking, we're conducting really intensive power line surveys across the three core areas for blue cranes. In the Swartland, as shown earlier, on the west coast of South Africa, we're covering 150 kilometers of power lines being surveyed by researchers. In conjunction with that, we're conducting the scavenger bias experiments, and I'll talk a little bit about scavenger biases moving forward. In the Overberg, we're looking at repeating the 2009 surveys that were undertaken in the Overberg area in the Western Cape, where we'll be surveying 199 kilometers of power lines, which is the same power line sample conducted in the same time of the year. We'll be repeating those surveys to look at comparison and see if there's been any changes in collision rates within that region over time. And then in addition, we're going to be looking at Blue Crane's stronghold within natural habitat, the Karoo, that central part of South Africa. We will be surveying 160 kilometers of power lines every 3 months, including a scavenger bias experiment within in the Karoo as well. So all of these will help to determine collision rates within those three core areas. And that, along with our tracking data, which I'll talk about now, we'll be looking at developing collision sensitivity maps for Blue Cranes to try and really hone in and drill down a proactive marking project moving forward. So looking at the scavenger bias experiments, this is essential for us conducting any kind of power line surveys to understand collision risk. We are obviously looking at snapshots in time with the surveys, so 3 month intervals. So in order to understand what we may be missing as a bias in terms of collisions as a result of carcasses that may have been scavenged by various scavengers, we have to undertake a scavenger bias experiment. This included essentially the placing out of carcasses of birds that were shot as part of legal shoots as part of controlling problem bird numbers of Egyptian geese. So we source these birds from local hunters associations and essentially place these carcasses at 1 kilometer intervals along power lines within the project area and established camera traps in order to identify what's scavenging on the carcasses and also how long the carcasses persist within the landscape. And interestingly, in the Swartland, all of the scavenging that was captured on the camera traps was as a result of other birds, particularly crows and other birds of prey. And after 2 weeks, 100% of all the carcasses placed out in the landscape were still present, where we could still see some evidence of the carcass. And thereafter, there was very little scavenging taking place once the carcass had desiccated. So the carcasses then persisted quite long within the landscape within the Swartland area. This, however, was slightly different in the Karoo area. So the central part of South Africa within the natural habitat landscape, the same methodology was used in terms of placing out carcasses with camera traps. But the difference in the Karoo was that most of the scavenging, actually all of the scavenging, was done by mammals, so slightly different to the Swartland area. And in most cases where scavenging occurred, there was complete removal of the carcass. So there was absolutely no sign of the carcass remaining under the power line. So this is really important information in order to understand scavenging rates of carcasses. So when we model collision rates for Blue Cranes, we can account for potentially the number of carcasses that may have been removed by scavenging before we've been able to get there and survey. So that bias is then accounted for in the modeling and allows us to ensure the modeling and the results of the modeling are a lot more accurate than just being based on what we find within the surveys. So in order to obviously understand collision sensitivity for Blue Crane specifically, we use the mortality data obviously to inform collision rates. So understanding sort of how many birds we are finding underneath the power line and once it's accounted for by the number of birds that could potentially be scavenged. We need to understand that Blue Crane biology plays a role in their risk to collide with the power line. So in this case, Blue Crane movement and landscape use is really important in understanding collision risk. It's not just about what we find in the birds, but understanding how the birds move within that landscape it helps in terms of strengthening the results of the modeling. So it's common sense, I suppose, but cranes are not always at risk of colliding with power lines every time they fly. There are clear factors such as height of the birds are flying, the time of the day the birds are flying, the direction they're flying, how much time they actually spend in the air, and other behaviors such as regular forage and roost sites. So sort of that their level of site dependency, I suppose, where they would use the same areas over and over again. So with this in mind, we have fitted 26 satellite trackers to blue cranes in the Western Cape and the Karoo, and we aim to fit another 12 trackers this year as the final sample. And together with the tracking data and the mortality data, will be used essentially to model collision risk for the species in two of their stronghold areas, the Western Cape and the Karoo. I think we'll go a really long way in really understanding those collision hotspot or collision prone areas for the species. So in conclusion and to end off, I think it's really important to know and acknowledge that blue cranes are one of South Africa's most impacted species in terms of power lines and power line collisions. And in the recent past, high breeding productivity in the Western Cape particularly has really nullified the impact of these high collision rates that we see in the same area. But given their dependency on a completely artificial or a transformed landscape, agricultural landscape, they're incredibly vulnerable species to change. And these increases we are seeing are not currently being seen in their natural habitat range. So this makes them even more vulnerable. And I think what's really important is that we have to be proactive in our approach. We hold the world's population of blue cranes and also not forgetting either crane species, the only increasing population of grey crown cranes in the world. So we have, as a country, a responsibility to ensure we are proactive in our approach to conserving our cranes and not assume, because they are increasing in numbers across some of their core range, that they do not require conservation attention. With blue cranes being so heavily reliant on agricultural wheat and pasture lands in the Western Cape, they are vulnerable to any additional changes that may drive a negative impact on their breeding productivity, such as reduced suitable habitat for breeding or persistent irregular droughts reducing chick survival, for example, or increased mortality as a result of increased energy infrastructure. Specifically, the large parts of the Western Cape is being deemed highly suitable for wind energy production and we are witnessing increases in wind farms monthly within South Africa. So ultimately we aim to understand the resilience of our landscape and the resilience of the blue crane population specifically, which ultimately will be synthesized into a detailed conservation plan for blue cranes, which will have a strong focus on collaborative conservation efforts that will not only look to conserve the species, but will support the continued rise of the species to their former abundance in South African landscape. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining me tonight or this morning and your time for that presentation. I hope you guys really enjoyed it, and I look forward to addressing some of your questions posed. So feel free to write some questions as I move through the questions that are going through here, guys. Cool. So we have our first question for everybody. So the question we have here, what is the expected longevity of old devices? Seems like they might degrade within a few years. Wade, yeah, thanks for that question. These obviously still fairly new devices that have been fitted. So longevity, the answer to the longevity of the old devices is still in question. Park it, and hopefully in a couple of years we'll be able to get back to you on that. But I'd say the longest devices have been up successfully for the last 4 years in this country, and with fairly low levels of device failure so far. So, and obviously every area within South Africa is quite different as well. So I think longevity with the old devices across our country will differ based on the harsh conditions that vary across the landscape. Cool. So we have a few other questions here. We have a question around, have we tried using UV lights to mark the lines? This is a really good question. To date, we haven't, definitely not in the field, but there are options, and particularly looking at devices specifically for bustards. So the devices to date, which are cost effective, are pretty effective for most of the collision prone species, but we do definitely need to look at mitigation measures that are successful for busteds, and this has definitely been flagged as one of the options for busteds specifically. So a great question here, which I would definitely would like to answer, is around what is the cost or return on investment value proposition from the utility company's perspective. So this is a great question, and it's a question we get constantly from our utility company, Eskom, is around really understanding the return on investment. And I think that's one, there is a return on investment that's hard to quantify financially, but there is definitely a return on investment that you can quantify. And a lot of that is really related to the cost, the cost to the utility companies as a result of power outages caused by wildlife interactions. So many times bird collisions, bird electrocutions, or other wildlife electrocutions cause dips in the power supply. They can cause complete trips of the power supply, and they can also impact on the longevity of the infrastructure in terms of needing maintenance a lot more regularly. So our approach has really been around that it helps to mitigate these impacts, these wildlife power interaction impacts, from a cost perspective for the company. So they obviously, an outage is a loss of income revenue potential, and also in terms of a cost to repair the line or get the power back on. So that's been fairly easy to, I say fairly easy, it's not easy, but that has been one of the ways we have been able to demonstrate return on investment from a utility company's perspective. The other way is really looking at, is around reputational risk and how important that is for a utility company. It's a bit harder to quantify as a return on investment, but maybe it's more along the lines of a value proposition is around reputational risk. For South Africa's perspective, our utility company playing an active role in the conservation of our national bird goes a really long way from a reputational perspective. So yeah, I hope I've gone some way to answering that. Okay, some other questions here. We have, could power lines be buried in the areas where cranes are found? Yes, the burying of power lines is definitely an option. Sort of the willingness for power utility companies to bury power lines will differ probably country to country and continent to continent. Generally, the response we get is, and rightly so, is that one, it's quite expensive to bury the power lines, but more importantly, the maintenance of power lines and the finding of faults, the fixing or addressing of faults with buried power lines is a lot more difficult than power lines up. And if we've got a very effective mitigation measure in terms of marking the line, you know, that may be a more cost-effective approach for a power utility company to undertake. I think the first mitigation measure must always be around the placement of power lines, and where at all possible, the placement and the design of the power line needs to consider these sensitive areas and looking at that first. That obviously doesn't answer the question for existing power lines, but for any new power lines being built, you should look at placement and design first and foremost. And any leftover impacts need to then be mitigated as cost effectively as possible. Okay, so we have another question here around from Mwape saying he knows that the study is still going on. Thanks, Mwape. But what are we expecting in terms of blue crane trends in the next 100 years? It's a really good question, Mwape. I think we are definitely seeing a species that's potentially on a knife's edge. We have a species that has adapted incredibly well to the artificial agricultural landscape of the Western Cape. So we have seen a big shift in range where most of our birds have moved and are now found in the wheat and pasture fields of that area. And I think that just makes them incredibly vulnerable to changes which are not only predicted for the future, but we are currently seeing. These are impacts or modeled or projected impacts around climate change, which have predicted that the Western Cape will become a lot drier and a lot hotter as a result of climate change. We've seen that already. We've come off the back of the worst drought that the Western Cape has seen in living memory in South Africa. It's definitely hotter and drier in that Western Cape area. And some of the initial data is suggesting that we're no longer seeing the increase we were seeing for sort of 15 consecutive years in that area. We're seeing what's appearing to be a tapering off, and even what some people would say a slight decline, sort of since 2009. So that makes this study really, really important to really understand, can this increase be sustained? My opinion is it can't be in these areas. And we're not seeing the same increases in their natural habitat range of the grasslands and the Karoo. So the population sustainability at the moment, or the viability, is being sustained by the Western Cape portion of the population, which is incredibly vulnerable to change. So my feeling is 100 years from now, we are either going to be very happy we did something and didn't rest on our laurels, or we're going to be really upset that we didn't do anything and close to losing our national bird. Cool. So we had another question here around, other than Egyptian geese, what other pest birds were used in the scavenger study? We only used Egyptian geese in the scavenger study. They're not a protected species in South Africa, and they are currently controlled legally through permits that are legally through permits that allow the hunters to shoot the birds on behalf of farmers to control problem birds. So yeah, obviously it's not a crane, and potentially desirability of the bird species would influence scavenging rates. But what was interesting in the Karoo is that we had over 50% of the carcasses scavenged within the first 4 days of placing out the carcasses. So most of the scavenging, at least in the Karoo, took place while the carcasses were incredibly fresh. We are going to repeat the scavenger bias experiments in winter as well, so we can have a look at seasonal differences between summer and winter in this country as well. Cool. So next question we have here is, are we working with staff in North America to share your lessons learned to help with sandhill and whooping crane power line collisions? The short answer is yes, most definitely. As I mentioned at the beginning, our work is a fully integrated partnership between the International Crane Foundation and the Endangered Wildlife Trust. So we are colleagues and friends, and we share those lessons as much as possible. We've even had Anne Lacey, who some of you may have had the pleasure of listening to her talk last week, come out to South Africa a few times, even as recently as last year, where we can also then look at sharing those lessons learned from here with North America staff. Cool. So we have a question here. What is the estimated population size for blue cranes? This is a good question. Unfortunately, our best estimates for the population of blue cranes is really out of date. Our last population estimates based on national crane counts that were done was from 2005. So the best estimate we have at the moment nationally is around 35,000 blue cranes. But that is going to be tweaked and updated through this PhD that's currently underway. Christy's looking at, we've conducted aerial surveys in the Western Cape last year, and we'll be conducting aerial surveys in the Eastern Cape, which is the Karoo part of their population, where we'll then look at potentially using modeling like distance sampling to try and get a really good estimate of population size within those areas using aerial surveys. So we are really hoping to update that population survey, a population estimate fairly soon. Cool. So we have here, okay. So we have a question here saying, do these cranes use the agricultural fields? And what is the impact of agricultural pesticides and poisoning on these crane species? So yes, cranes, all three crane species to some degree, but particularly blue cranes do use the agricultural fields. They forage naturally within the harvested fields. So the wheat and maize lands that are harvested, the cranes do forage in those areas. But also fairly unique to the Western Cape, blue cranes are, they do tend to be found at sheep feeding troughs. So essentially where farmers are feeding sheep with a mixture of different sort of mineral licks and maize. The blue cranes have adapted to using those feed troughs. The farmers are incredibly tolerant of cranes. We are very fortunate to have incredibly tolerant farmers, and I think that's testament to 30 years of working very closely with farmers. Most of our cranes are obviously found outside of protected areas, so most of our birds are in the hands of farmers, essentially, as their custodians. So generally speaking, the farmers are very tolerant. In terms of the impact of pesticides and poisonings, we do unfortunately see some accidental or incidental poisonings of cranes as a result of interacting with these agricultural landscapes. In terms of understanding the impact of pesticides, we don't know that yet. But it was something that we definitely looked at flagging as part of this research study, but unfortunately it's obviously just getting too big to include that, but it is something we want to understand in the future. Cool. So we have a question here then around, are there any plans of distributing these devices to other parts of Africa, especially where cranes breed? Yes, so I think what is really interesting is that Eskom as a power utility or power supplier in South Africa is also a major power supplier through Africa and to other African countries. In addition to that, we are looking at strengthening a relationship with Power Africa, which is a sort of consortium body that looks at supporting countries in developing power producing projects, large scale, either hydro or non-renewable based energy productions. So we are definitely looking at how we can support the lessons that we've learned here through our strategic partnership with Eskom and take those more broadly. Specifically, we've already initiated work in Uganda quite strongly with this relationship between Eskom and Power Africa. We have also done some work in Botswana around an initial assessment of looking at high-risk areas and looking at infrastructure design and a proposed way forward in Botswana, and as well some preliminary work in Zambia as well. So we definitely, there's a lot of room to expand on that moving forward, and I think it's an incredibly exciting opportunity to take what we've learned in South Africa so we don't replicate the same mistakes we've made in this country in terms of line design, line placement, and mitigation measures. Cool. So, we have some other apologies. I forgot to move through my last slides. I do apologize to everybody. You forget when you start diving into questions. So if we continue to look at some of those questions over the next couple of minutes, we have a question here that says, the graph showed grey crown cranes plateauing and might trend down. Is this a concern? So I think what is interesting with grey crown cranes is that we had an initial incredibly steep increase in numbers in the early 2000s, but we have definitely noticed a sort of a plateauing or a slow in the rate of that increase annually based on our aerial survey counts. So I don't think it's something to be too concerned about to date. I think we might also just be getting to a situation where some of the available habitat can't accommodate the increasing numbers, or at least the rates of increase we were seeing in South Africa, specifically in KwaZulu-Natal. But hopefully that plateauing is also maybe the first hints or signs of birds leaving the province of KwaZulu-Natal, which is the stronghold, and maybe re-establishing areas across their former range in Mpumalanga and the Eastern Cape provinces along that eastern escarpment. Cool. Okay, so we have another question around how cooperative have farmers been in supporting our conservation work? I think I alluded to it previously, but farmers generally have been incredibly supportive. Most of the declines we saw in cranes and in this country in the 1980s and early 1990s was mostly as a result of conflict with landowners. We saw large-scale poisoning of cranes as a result of agricultural crop damage. It also then coincided with a time in our country where there was a lot of habitat transformation from grasslands and wetlands to large-scale plantation forestry, agriculture and mining. So the two sort of mixed threats of habitat loss and direct persecution really drove the declines of our three crane species. But through massive concerted effort with by conservation groups, both by our government provincial conservation agencies, as well as NGOs like the Endangered Wildlife Trust and others, really have focused a lot on landowner engagement, landowner awareness, and really trying to address some of those conflict issues that were arising, and obviously addressing maybe some of the impacts that were as a result of I suppose ignorance for want of a better word. So I think we have an incredibly strong relationship with landowners across most of the core range of cranes within South Africa, and I think that's something to be incredibly proud about. Cool. Okay, so last question here is essentially would the presentation be shared with everybody who's interested? So yes. So essentially everyone who has been on this call, or even if you haven't been on the presentation, but you registered for the webinar, you will receive a link with the recording of this PowerPoint presentation. So you will be able to rewatch it or to share it with everybody moving forward. So that is it. I think thank you everyone for your questions. If I didn't get to your questions, I'll definitely re-look at those that were posed and look at circulating some of the questions with the link to the webinar recording. And I hope you guys enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed giving it. And I just wanted to end off really just give a shout out to our next webinar, which will be presented next week, the 23rd of April. It will be presented by Liz Smith, who is an absolutely awesome colleague and friend, and is our North America Program Director within the International Crane Foundation. She's going to be giving a great talk on whooping cranes and the last wild whooping crane population in Texas, in the US. So hopefully you guys can all sign in for that and join Liz for her webinar. And I think just also last shout out is just a massive thanks to the Leiden Conservation Foundation, specifically Tom and Kathy Leiden, for their support, not only of this webinar and the presentation I gave here, but also for all our work in South Africa on blue cranes, and really buying into the need to do this work for an incredibly special species that as a country we're completely responsible for. So, you know, hoping that future generations get to enjoy them as much as we enjoy them now. So thanks everyone for joining me, and stay safe and sane, I suppose, in all your various lockdowns that you have around the world. From South Africa, we're in a fairly severe lockdown, So looking forward to getting back into the field after this lockdown is lifted. But thanks to everyone. Have a good day or a good evening, and hope to meet you guys all in future. Thanks.